Jesus Christ is the light of the world. Jesus Christ is the light of the world.
Light of darkness to overcome.
Jesus Christ is the light of the world.
Light of darkness to overcome.
Stay with us, Lord, for it is evening. Sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Grant us peace.
Gracious Jesus, very Lamb of God.
At this hour, before our sin, in your own body on the tree, you did this so that we, being dead to sin, might live for righteousness.
Have mercy on us now and at the hour of our death. And give us a holy and peaceful life in this world.
Jesus, Lamb of God, take away my sin.
Have mercy on us.
Jesus, Lamb of God, take away my sin.
Grant us peace.
Through your grace, grant us eternal glory with the life to come. Where the Father and the Holy Spirit, you live and rule, one God forever.
Jesus, the Lamb of God, has taken away the sin of the world. By the command of Christ and through the redeeming power of his death, I forgive you your sins in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Over the past several years, I have managed to collect a bunch of cross jewelry, necklaces, and things like that. I brought some of them with me tonight. It wasn't an intentional collection, it just sort of happened over time. Here's one that I purchased recently, and to be honest with you, I'm not sure why. It's not really me, but it's really big and it's really beautiful. It's got some inlays in it and some black coloring, and I just liked it. I'm not sure when I'm gonna wear it, but I liked it. Here's one, I don't have a chain for it, but here's one that my wife gave me, this cross, long ago. It's the cross that was sort of made famous in the movies The Fast and the Furious, and my wife knew that I liked those movies, so she got me this cross. It says on the back that it's silver plated, and it has some things that look like diamonds in it, but it's probably not real diamonds. It's definitely shiny and pretty though, isn't it? Here's one, it's made out of wood. Again, the wood is pretty smooth, it's not really shiny, but inside the wood then is some carving and some gold inlay that symbolizes Christ. Here's a pin, it's not a cross, but here's a pin, it's a lapel pin, it's the LCMS cross, it's probably obligatory that a pastor should have something like that in the LCMS. Here's one that I wear a lot, it's kind of nice, it's got some ropes around it that tie the pieces together, so it looks kind of rugged. Here's another one that's a fairly new purchase that I got. It is very shiny, and I like this one too. I might start wearing this one a lot more. Perhaps you have some cross jewelry too, and it would be very predictable if you did. The cross as a Christian is a very normal symbol. We have them all over the place in this sanctuary. I don't know if you realize this, but the crucifer carried in the cross a little bit ago, and we put it in this stand back here, and even this stand that it goes in is clipped with another cross. We have crosses everywhere. They're on the pews. They're up there. They're even on our stoles that Pastor Kreitzer and I are wearing today. It's quite normal for Christians to have a cross, but I wonder though, some people might think it's odd that we have these crosses that are all shiny and that we wear jewelry shaped like a cross. The cross was, after all, a very violent, a very gruesome, and yes, very effective method of torture and punishment and death. Crucifixion was used by the Roman government during the period of Western history that we call the Pax Romana. Pax Romana means the Roman peace. And historians have observed that during Jesus' day, during the Pax Romana, this period of history featured a time of relative tranquility, relative prosperity, and yes, relative peace. It just seems rather ironic that this cross was used to establish and keep the peace. Now you can easily find, if you look on the internet or through a library or magazines, you can find all kinds of respectable articles that talk about the cause of death that came from a cross, and many of them can be quite explicit, but they all basically agree. And here's sort of a PG version of that. First off, we have to remember that crucifixion always led to death. There were no other options. If you were sentenced to be crucified, you were going to die. And it was typical for the person who was sentenced to be crucified to be whipped or flogged beforehand, and then that person would be forced to drag their cross through the streets to the final place of the actual crucifixion. And that final place of punishment was usually a very, very public place. The people who were crucifying this person wanted that person to be an example. Whatever that person did, you don't want to do that. It was a very public thing. And there at the final place of punishment is where the person would be bound to the cross. First, the arms would be nailed to the crossbeam, and the nails would go through the wrist, as it turns out. Now, the human body contains several nerves in the arm that run up and down through the arm and eventually into the spine and into the brain, and they're all concentrated in the wrist. So a nail piercing the wrists would cause excruciating pain. In fact, the word excruciating means out of the cross. Ex is out of, and cruce is the cross. So excruciating pain, my friends, is the pain that comes from the cross. Now, I've experienced a lot of pain in my day, but I'm kind of grateful. I think I haven't experienced excruciating pain. And then once the arms were attached to the cross was posted into the ground with the body hanging on it, and eventually the feet would be nailed to the cross as well. And from that moment on, every breath would cause even more pain. As the person tried to breathe, it would slide up, the body would slide up and down the cross, and the wood of the cross was not smooth and polished and pretty like this. If there was good wood that was smooth, it was going to be used for palaces and chariots and things like that. The wood of the cross was gnarly. And death on a cross ultimately occurred through a combination of low blood flow and asphyxiation. And if a person took too long to die, whatever that meant, the executioners would then use a metal bar to break the legs of the person, and this would speed along the asphyxiation process. But Jesus had been whipped and beaten so badly before being hung on the cross that he died before it became necessary for him to be hit with that iron bar. Instead, the executioners pierced his side with a spear. You'll remember that part of the story too. And John tells us that blood and water flowed. That too is something quite normal when a human body dies from asphyxiation and low blood flow. What little bit of blood comes out with something that looks quite a bit like water. So yes, some people might think it's very odd for Christians to wear jewelry shaped like a cross, especially polished and pretty. We certainly wouldn't think about wearing a piece of jewelry that looks like an electric chair, would we? But of course, it is the cross of Jesus that brings us here tonight, and yes, Christians see the cross as a good thing. This is, after all, Good Friday. And it was on a Friday that Jesus was on the cross. And in the next several minutes, then, as we proceed through this service, we're going to read the account of Jesus' final journey to the cross as we find it in John's Gospel. And I want to talk about some important moments. There's all kinds of moments to teach and preach in that particular account, but I want to talk about a few of them that I hope will recapture your attention for a little bit. Notice that when Jesus was arrested, or was about to be arrested, he was in the garden, and he didn't retreat and hide in the darkness of the night. He actually, you'll see, intentionally approached the search party. He went out and asked them, "Who is it that you want?" He knew who they wanted and why, but he did it intentionally. He went to them. And then as he was being arrested, you'll remember that Peter attempted to prevent the whole process. He took a knife and he attacked one of the servants, and Jesus told Peter to stop. He reminded Peter that he needed to be arrested. It was necessary in order for him to complete his mission. And then when Jesus was on trial with the Jewish leaders, and it really wasn't a very real trial, he didn't protest being on trial, even though it was a fake trial. He certainly could have protested, but instead he reminded the Jewish leaders that he had done nothing in secret. Why did they have him on trial? Everything he did out in the open. He was never trying to evade or avoid the moment that was coming. In fact, he was intentionally and purposefully heading directly toward this moment. And then later, Pilate was asking Jesus all kinds of questions, and eventually Jesus simply gave no answer. Again, there was no attempt by Jesus to evade or avoid or use some kind of political loophole, and he probably could have found a political loophole, but he didn't do that. He didn't try to wiggle out of what was happening. He willingly let it happen. Now, as I said, we're going to read John's account of the crucifixion, but Mark's gospel gives us another little tidbit that we want to think about. Mark tells us that just before Jesus was nailed to the cross, the executioners offered him some wine mixed with myrrh. Now that odd-sounding elixir was believed to be some kind of a pain reliever. I don't know why exactly they would have offered it to somebody being crucified, but they did. And I don't know if it actually is a pain elixir, but that's not the point. What we read in Mark's gospel is that Jesus did not take any of that wine, myrrh, pain reliever kind of thing. He didn't want to reduce or numb anything. He purposefully experienced everything that the cross would bring. And then, going back to John's account, we'll hear that when Jesus died, he gave up his spirit. At the time, that would have been a very odd way to say that he died. But you'll notice that it's Jesus being active. He didn't succumb to death. He gave up his spirit to death. So here's why I'm hoping you'll notice all those little moments. From the moment that Jesus was conceived until the moment he died, he was necessarily and intentionally and purposefully and actively and willingly suffering every possible human struggle, every possible human indignity, every possible kind of pain, including that gruesome death on a cross. And he did it so that you and I can be certain that his work, his life, his death, and even his abandonment by his Father. You'll remember that's one of the last things he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? So Jesus did all that so that we can be certain that it was for us, for people. Every bit of it was what we deserve, but he took every bit of it for us, and we can be sure of that. And yes, he considered all of it good, and we do too. As we know all too well, as long as we do live in this life, we will continue to encounter our own kind of heartache and suffering and indignity and pain and even eventually death. But no matter how difficult all of that might get for us, it will never be as difficult as it was for Jesus. And on account of our faith in the work that he did, we will never be abandoned by our Father. Friends, let me sum it up this way. In the book of Isaiah, we are told that Jesus would be one who was familiar with suffering. But I say it this way. Jesus left no stone of suffering unturned for us. And then he stayed in the tomb until another stone was turned. But that's a message for another day.
Thank you.
praying, Jesus left his disciples and crossed the Kidron Valley. On the other side, there was an olive garden, and he and his disciples went into it. Now Judas, who betrayed him, knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas came to the grove, guiding a detachment of soldiers and some officials from the chief priests and the Pharisees. Jesus, knowing all that was going to happen to him, he went out and asked them, "Who is it you want?" And they replied, "I am he," Jesus said. And when Jesus said, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. Again, he asked them, "Who is it you want?" And again, they said,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
"I told you that I am he," Jesus answered. "If you are looking for me, then let these men go." And this happened so that the words he had spoken would be fulfilled. "I have not lost one of those you gave me." Jesus commanded Peter, "Put your sword away. Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me?"
Let us pray for the whole Christian church, that our Lord God would defend her against all the assaults and temptations of the adversary, keep her perpetually on the true foundation, Jesus Christ, and enable her to carry her crosses. Almighty
and everlasting God, keep your church safe throughout the world, defending her against Satan, and equip her to overcome all of you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
and the Jewish officials arrested Jesus. They bound him and brought him first to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Simon Peter and another disciple were following Jesus. Because this disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the high priest's courtyard. But Peter had to wait outside at the door. The other disciple, who was known to the high priest, came back, spoke to the girl on duty there, and brought Peter in. The girl at the door asked Peter, he replied, "I am not." It was cold, and the servants and officials stood around a fire they had made to keep warm. Peter also was standing with them, warming himself. Meanwhile, the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. "I have spoken openly to the world," Jesus replied. "I always taught in the synagogues or at the temple, where all the Jews come together. I said nothing in secret. Why question me? Ask those who heard me. Surely they know what I said." When Jesus said this, one of the officials nearby struck him in the face.
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
"If I said something wrong," Jesus replied, "testify as to what was wrong. But if I spoke the truth, why did you strike me?" Then Annas sent him, still bound, to Caiaphas, the high priest. As Simon Peter stood warming himself, he was asked,
"You are not one of his disciples, are you?"
He denied it, saying, "I am not." One of the high priest's servants, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, challenged him, Again, Peter denied it, and at that moment, a rooster began to crow.
And then the Jews led Jesus from Caiaphas to the palace of the Roman governor. And by now it was early morning, and to avoid ceremonial uncleanness, the Jews did not enter the palace. They wanted to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and asked, "What charges are you bringing against this man?" And they replied, Pilate said, "Take him yourself and judge him by your own law." And they objected. This happened so that the words Jesus had spoken, indicating the kind of death he was going to die, would be fulfilled. Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Is that your own idea? Jesus asked. Or did others talk to you about me? And Pilate replied, Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jews. But now, my kingdom is from another place." And Pilate said,
"You are a king."
And Jesus answered, "You are right in saying I am a king. In fact, for this reason I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." "What is truth?" Pilate asked. With this, he went out again to the Jews and said, "I find no basis for a charge against him. But it is your custom for me to release to you one prisoner at the time of Passover. Do you want me to release the king of the Jews?" They shouted back,
"No, not him. Give us Barabbas."
Let us pray for all who are not yet believers in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that God would call them to faith in him and gather them into his family, the church. Almighty and everlasting God, because you do not want anyone to be lost to you, hear our prayers for all who do not yet believe in you. Open their eyes, hearts, and minds to the wonder of your glory, and bring them into the body of your holy church, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. The soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head. They clothed him in a purple robe, and striking him in the face, they went up to him again and again and again, saying, Once more, Pilate came out and said to the Jews, Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no basis for a charge against him. And when Jesus came out wearing this crown of thorns and the purple robe, Pilate said to them, Here is the man. And as soon as the chief priests and their officials saw him, they shouted,
Crucify! Crucify! Let him be crucified!
But Pilate answered, You take him and crucify him. As for me, I find no basis for a charge against him. And the Jews insisted,
We have a law, and according to that law, he must have it, because he claims to be the Son of God.
And when Pilate heard this, he was even more afraid, and he went back inside the palace. Where do you come from? He asked Jesus, but Jesus gave him no answer. Do you refuse to speak to me? Pilate said. Don't you realize I have the power to free you or to crucify you? And Jesus answered, You would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin. From then on, Pilate tried to set Jesus free, but the Jews kept shouting, When Pilate heard this, he brought Jesus out and sat down in the judge's seat at the palace known as the Stone of Pavement. It was the first day of preparation of Passover week, about the sixth hour. Here is your king, Pilate said to the Jews, but they shouted,
Take him away! Take him away! Crucify him!
Shall I crucify your king? Pilate asked. The chief priests answered, Finally, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified.
Let us pray to our Lord God Almighty that he would deliver the world from all terror, take away disease, ward off famine, set free those who are oppressed, give health to the sick, and a safe journey to all who travel. Almighty and everlasting God,
thank you.
Please rise. So the soldiers took charge of Jesus, and carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, and here they crucified him with two others, one on each side and Jesus in the middle. And Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened it to the cross, and it read, Many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and the sign was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. And the chief priests of the Jews protested to Pilate,
Do not write the name of the Jews, but let this man claim to be the king of the Jews.
And Pilate answered, What I have written, I have written. And when the soldiers crucified Jesus, they took his clothes, dividing them into four shares, one for each of them, with the undergarment remaining. And this garment was seamless, woven into one piece from top to bottom. And they said to one another, This happened that the scripture might be fulfilled, which said,
Let us pray for all in authority that we might lead quiet and peaceable lives that reflect godliness and honesty. O merciful Father in heaven, you hold in your hand all the power of humanity for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of those who do well throughout all the world. We humbly pray for guidance and protection of all who serve in our church, community, country, state, nation, and in each nation in the world, through Jesus Christ our Lord. On the cross of Jesus stood his mother, his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there, and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, and to the disciple, from that time on, this disciple took her into his home. Later, knowing that all was now completed, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, I am thirsty. A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on the stalk of a hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, It is finished.
Now it was the day of preparation, and the next day was to be a special Sabbath. Because the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, they asked Pilate to have the legs broken and the bodies taken down. The soldiers, therefore, came and broke the legs of the first man who had been crucified with Jesus, and then those of the other. But when they came to Jesus and found that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear, bringing a sudden flow of blood and water. And the man who saw this has given testimony, and his testimony is true. He knows that if he tells the truth and testifies so that you may also believe. And these things happened so that the scripture would be fulfilled. And as another scripture says,
Holy Father, merciful Lord, God of grace, in your great love for us, you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer and die on the cross, that we might joyfully live in you. Grant that all who die find salvation in his death. Grant that all who suffer find consolation in his suffering. Grant that all who are rejected find acceptance in his condemnation. Finally, grant that all who live find hope in his life. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
Please stand. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer. By night, but I find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praise of Israel, and you our fathers trusted, they trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were rescued, in you they trusted and were not put to shame.